Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. If you've not already done so, we suggest that you watch the video on Introduction to Maps before watching this video. Let's say you and your family are spending the day with friends on a boat, just off the coast of Oregon. You decide to come to this same place next week. But since this is part of the ocean, there are no street signs or addresses. The challenge is how to find this location again. The answer is to use latitude and longitude. In this video, we'll introduce what latitude and longitude lines are, where these lines are located, how they account for some map distortions, and how we use these lines with GPS technology. Before we solve a complicated problem like finding a specific place in an ocean, we'll see how people can find their way in some cities. Let's say you and your family are visiting a city like New York and staying in a hotel on the corner of 6th Avenue and 2nd Street. You hear about a wonderful ice cream shop on the corner of 3rd Avenue and 4th Street that you and your family want to walk to. Even if you don't have a map, you may be able to find it because the roads in this part of the city are shaped like a grid and the road names are numbers. For example, if you and your family are the Purple Star, then all you have to do is walk east on 6th Avenue until you get to 4th Street, then walk south on 4th Street until you get to 3rd Avenue. Most of the places on Earth do not have a grid system like a city, especially places with few people there. But we can pretend there's a grid and make imaginary lines. So long as everyone agrees on where these imaginary lines should be and what numbers to call each line, then everyone will know where each line is and how to get to a particular point. The most popular system of making an imaginary grid over the Earth's surface is by using latitude and longitude lines. We can see them as horizontal and vertical lines on this globe. The latitude lines are horizontal, and the longitude lines are vertical. One way to remember that the latitude lines are the horizontal ones is because they are lying down like layers on a cake. Both of the words latitude and layers start with the letters L and A. This schematic shows just a few of the lines of latitude and longitude. There are about 200 lines of latitude between the North Pole and the South Pole, which means there are almost 70 miles between each line of latitude. This may seem like too few lines to make a useful grid, but we can increase the precision by 10 times every time we add a place value to the right of the decimal point. For example, by the time we reach 6 decimal points, the difference between lines of latitude are less than 5 inches. With that precision, we could distinguish the location of each picket in this fence. We'll use this map to look at some latitude and longitude values. Part of the border between Canada and the continental U.S. is defined as the 49th parallel, which means the 49th line of latitude. The most southern part of the continental U.S. is at Florida's tip, which is just above the 24th line of latitude. If we move the mouse's pointer close to a line of latitude, we can see the first value, which is the value of latitude, stays about the same. But the second value, which is the value of the longitude, changes as we move the pointer. In contrast, if we move the mouse's pointer close to a line of longitude, then we see that the value of the longitude stays about the same, but the latitude's value changes. A pair of latitude and longitude values is called a coordinate. Although we cannot see the detailed grid lines, we can move the mouse pointer over any part of a map to see the unique coordinate for that area. For example, here's a table showing the unique coordinates for some state capitol buildings. Our GPS technology uses reference tables like this to find the coordinates when we enter an address of somewhere we want to go. Next, we'll introduce where the lines of latitude and longitude are located. In order for our GPS-enabled devices to work, there must be definitions of exactly where the lines are that make up this imaginary grid. There are several ways to find the lines. Let's start with latitude, which are the horizontal lines on the grid. The equator is a horizontal line that goes through the widest part of the Earth. We call that 0 degrees. Then, we put a protractor alongside the globe and mark where 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, and 80 degrees are. Next, we set a pen at each of these levels while rotating the globe. Since this is such a small globe, we'll only draw a few latitude lines. As we draw these, please note how each line is parallel to the others. That's why sometimes the latitude lines are called parallel lines of latitude. As a reminder, the word parallel means when one or more lines or other objects maintain an equal distance to each other. A classic example of parallel lines are railroad tracks. They always keep an equal distance from each other. The very top of the protractor is 90 degrees, which is the topmost point of the North Pole. It's a point, so we cannot draw a line at 90 degrees. When we look at the lines from the perspective of the North Pole, we see many circles which get smaller as they get closer to the North Pole. This is why sometimes we call lines of latitude by another term, which is circles of latitude. Everything above the equator is called the northern hemisphere. For example, the entire continental U.S. is above the equator, so it's in the northern hemisphere. Everything below the equator is called the southern hemisphere. Those also have lines of latitude between the equator and the South Pole. We call the South Pole negative 90 because it's in the opposite place as the North Pole. Next, let's look at how to find the lines of longitude. Each line of longitude runs from the North Pole to the South Pole. Unlike the circles of latitude, lines of longitude are not circles. They are half circles. Each one we draw will be close to its neighbor and crosses the equator at a perpendicular intersection. Even though it may seem like they are parallel on paper maps, all of the lines of longitude meet at the North Pole and at the South Pole, so they're not parallel. This is another difference than the parallel circles of latitude. Just like we divide the Earth into northern and southern hemispheres by using the equator, we can divide the Earth into an eastern and western half by using a vertical line in a place that everyone agrees on. People have chosen a place in London, England called Greenwich to have a longitudinal line value of 0 degrees. This line of longitude has a special name, which is the prime meridian. Next, we put the protractor on the North Pole with the protractor's 0-degree line on top of the prime meridian. Then we can see where each degree will be on the eastern hemisphere. We can repeat this process for the western hemisphere. But in order to have different numbers from the eastern hemisphere, we call the numbers in the western hemisphere negative. This is similar to how we call the numbers of latitude degrees in the southern hemisphere negative, to distinguish them from the latitude degrees in the northern hemisphere. Here's how the lines of longitude look on a map. The prime meridian is in the middle. The positive degrees are on the right. When there's no minus sign in front of a number, that means it's positive. The negative degrees are on the left. One way to remember that the negative longitude values are in the west is to think of a number line. On a number line, the numbers on the left of the zero are negative. Likewise, on a map, west is on the left of the prime meridian, which has a value of zero. So, west longitude values are negative. Sometimes people write a W letter to mean west, rather than write a negative symbol. Next, let's look at why some maps distort the globe. In the prior video, we showed that on some rectangular maps, countries near the poles can appear much larger compared to other countries. For example, on this globe, we can see that Greenland is smaller than this man's finger. But Africa is much larger than his finger. Whereas on a map, Greenland and Africa incorrectly appear to be about the same size. To demonstrate why this happens, we've drawn some countries on this fruit. When we try to lie the skin flat, it's impossible to do unless we make a few cuts or stretch the skin. Likewise, when mapmakers try to draw the countries and oceans of the world on a flat surface, they cannot do it unless they make cuts or stretch some parts. Here's one type of map that has cuts. But hundreds of years ago, sailors said maps with cuts in them were too complicated, and the sailors were afraid of getting lost at sea if they used those maps. The sailors preferred to have maps that had no cuts, even if that meant some countries would be the wrong size or shape. This rectangular map without cuts was invented almost 500 years ago and became very popular with sailors. It's still very popular today and is used by many internet websites and apps. To make this map, the mapmakers made the longitude lines parallel with each other instead of having them come to the same point as they do on a globe. In order to keep the lines of longitude parallel near the poles, the mapmakers stretched the width of countries near the poles. Then, in order to keep the shape of the countries correct, the mapmakers stretched the height of countries near the poles. The final result is a rectangular-shaped map without cuts, but the regions by the poles have been stretched. Next, let's see how GPS uses latitude and longitude. We'll return to our original question, which is how to find a specific point in the ocean. Modern GPS-enabled devices on our phones, cars, boats, and planes are able to calculate their exact location anywhere on the Earth. They do this by receiving signals from special GPS satellites. You can also use your GPS to mark a place you want to remember, such as where you were off Oregon's coast. Then, next time you want to return there, you can enter that as the destination coordinate and follow the path to return there. In the event of an emergency such as a broken engine, the captain can radio the Coast Guard, report the boat's GPS coordinate, and the Coast Guard may be able to get there quickly. Here's a summary of the topic we've just covered along with some extra information. Please pause the video if you wish to read this. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.